Hello, welcome everyone. Today actually we will see a very important topic in, you can even say it as current electricity or even the magnetic effect of electric current. When you speak about measurement of current, we actually talk about an instrument which is very important to us, and it's called galvanometer. Today we will see how a moving coil galvanometer functions. The galvanometer basically is a device which is going to detect current in the circuit. So what I must have is that a galvanometer should give you deflection for very small value of current even passing through that. So if I have a very small current, still the galvanometer is supposed to give me a deflection. Now basically, if you see, there are two different types of galvanometers. One is called moving coil type of galvanometer, the one which we regularly use in our laboratory. It is also called as table galvanometer because you can actually place it on a table and it's very easily portable. You can take it from one point to the other. The other type of galvanometer is called moving magnet type of galvanometer, and in this moving magnet type of galvanometer, it is actually a tangent type of galvanometer. In this, as the name itself is suggesting, the magnet is going to move inside the coil. What I find is that we are today going to talk only about this moving coil type of galvanometer, in which the coil is going to move. In this, once again, we are going to have two different types of galvanometers. One is called pivoted type of galvanometer. The other is suspended type of galvanometer. Now, actually, a normal galvanometer and even ballistic galvanometer, which we are using in laboratory, they are both of moving coil type. Now, in this, the coil is going to move or rotate in a magnetic field whenever current flows through this. What is the basic idea or principle of working behind this? We have stated it here, that whenever there is a current carrying coil placed in the uniform magnetic field, it will always experience a torque because of that external magnetic field, and that torque is given by torque is equal to NIAB sine theta. So this is the basic idea or the principle of working behind moving coil galvanometer, where of course you see N are number of turns of the coil, I is current flowing through the coil, A is the average area per single turn of a coil, B is the strength of the magnetic field, or you call it as magnetic induction, and theta is the angle between area vector and magnetic field B. Now, normally my table galvanometer, which we are going to use in laboratory, they are going to look something like this. It is having its positive terminal as well as negative terminal. It's a you can say bipolar device. You can also connect it in the reverse manner. The galvanometer will be able to give both sided deflection. So when current flows from one direction to the other, it will supposing give you deflection to the right, then you connect it in the reverse manner, it will probably give you deflection to the left side. Now this whole instrument, which looks somewhat this big, the entire assembly of a table galvanometer is going to be just between this particular region which we are showing here. So in this region you are going to have this particular thing. That entire small region over here, this is going to have the entire working system of coil and magnets. That its magnified diagram has been shown somewhere here on the right hand side. I find that it is consisting of two concave pole pieces of magnet. One is north pole, the other is south pole. They are both strong concave pole pieces of magnet. Then you have inside these two, you have got a soft iron cylindrical core, cylindrical it is. This diagram is as good as I am seeing it from the top. So I am able to see only the upper circular face of that, on which large number of turns of copper wire, insulated copper wire, that is wound on it. And there is also a restoring spring over here, if you see, which appears like a spiral coil, which is attached to this pointer. The purpose of this spiral spring is to get this pointer back to the original position whenever there is not going to be any current flowing through this. This plus B and minus B, they are your connecting terminals actually of the wire. These two terminals are actually connected to this coil itself. Now, the purpose of this cylindrical soft iron core is that it creates a strong magnetic field as well as a radial magnetic field. So, concave pole pieces and this cylindrical soft iron core, they are going to produce a strong and radial magnetic field. I'll now go for what is the construction part of that. Once again, it is showing you the assembly here. It is consisting of two concave pole pieces of a strong horseshoe magnet. Cylindrical soft iron core is placed between the two concave pole pieces. Now, what's going to happen is it's going to produce a strong radial magnetic field, and large number of turns of a thin insulated copper wire are placed either on the core, or sometimes there is an aluminium rectangular frame on which the wire is wound, and whenever current flows through the coil, it gets deflected, and this pointer which is attached to this coil, that will also get deflected. Now, before we actually go for theory of working, we have already studied in principle of working that there is a deflecting torque given by tau deflecting is equal to NIAB sin theta. That was when you had a uniform magnetic field. Now, we'll see a very beautiful animation here in which it shows that right now here, if I see, I have got a coil, only one such single turn of a coil has been shown, and this coil is carrying current in this particular direction. If you see, this is the direction of current which is shown. So, current flows through in this manner. So, there is a magnetic moment associated with this coil. Every current carrying coil acts like a magnet, and there is a magnetic moment associated to this coil which is going to act inside this towards the left hand side of the face of the coil here. Now, this magnetic moment or this coil acting as a magnet which is placed in the external magnetic field which is pointing down will try to get this magnetic moment which was on the left hand side, it will try to get it in the downward direction. If it tries to get it in the downward direction, ultimately the movement of the coil has to be in the anti-clockwise sense. Now, I'll start this animation and try to see if it's actually going to move in the anti-clockwise sense. So, I'll start with it. Yes, and it moves. So, now you find that this black arrows, they are showing me what is the direction of force. Now, what I find is that the force is maximum when you have this coil placed exactly in the plane of the magnetic field. So, the plane of the coil is in the direction of the plane of the magnetic field, and you have got the maximum torque acting on it. Whereas, when the plane of the coil is at right angles, so at that time there was no force acting on it. Because there was a force acting in this direction one, they were cancelling each other's effect. They were both in the same direction, in the opposite direction, acting along the same line, and that was going to give you zero torque. So, this is what is going to happen for a single turn of a coil. And in this one single turn of a coil, when you had this type of a situation, maybe when it was having maximum torque acting along the coil, at that time, the torque acting is given by IAB. If you had n such number of turns, the torque is given by NIAB. What we are trying to achieve by using that radial magnetic field is that in each and every turn of a coil, in each and every such single turn of a coil, you are having the magnetic field in the direction of plane of the coil. You can take any one turn and you have a magnetic field in its own direction, whereas the all other remaining magnetic fields, they will produce equal and opposite torques, and the resultant torque which is going to act on every coil, it will be only one single turn of coil will only be equal to IAB. This is of one such turn. Because we have got n such number of turns, the entire deflecting torque is equal to NIAB. The coil will get deflected because of this. Now, once the coil gets deflected, this spring, restoring spring, that will come into action, and this restoring spring will try to have restoring torque acting on it, and that restoring torque is going to be given by torque restoring is equal to N, that is equal to K times of theta, where K is the torque constant or restoring torque per unit twist, you call it as torque constant of the coil. So, if you say that the deflection has been produced and the pointer achieves an equilibrium, it's only because the deflecting torque and this restoring torque, they both are equal. So at equilibrium you find that this tau deflecting is equal to tau restoring, and therefore you find this NIAB is equal to K times of theta I find, and therefore I find that I is equal to, I can transform the terms, it will be K upon NAB times of theta, where this quantity on the right hand side inside the bracket K upon NAB, where K is the restoring torque constant of the spring, N is number of turns. Once you design a galvanometer, the number of turns cannot change. A is area of one such single turn of a coil, B is the strength of the radial magnetic field. That strength of the radial magnetic field can decrease over the time, but it will not be suddenly happening. It will happen over the years that the strength of the magnetic field can decrease. So when you are performing the experiment, only two things are likely to change in this case. One is this I and the other is this theta. You increase current I and you will have greater deflection. So greater is the current, greater is the deflection. So I find I is directly proportional to theta, or theta is directly proportional to I. So it tells you that deflection produced in moving coil galvanometer is directly proportional to current I flowing through the coil. And that's what we really wanted to have. If you have more current flowing through the galvanometer, you need to have greater deflection in that. If you have smaller current, you need to have a smaller deflection. Now, once again, I come to that particular animation part and I show you. You can once again try and apply your logic and try to see that whenever you have this current flowing through the coil is going to have a torque acting on that. That torque is equal to, basically, we have a formula in magnetism that torque acting on a magnet is MB sine theta. But for a current carrying coil, that M is equal to NIA, so the torque, deflecting torque, is equal to NIAB sine theta. So this is showing you that if I have one such turn of a single coil, you have got a torque acting on this. In this particular situation, the torque is equal to, here if you see, it is the maximum torque, and that torque is equal to IAB only. You don't have this theta, is actually the angle between vector area. Vector area is taken in this direction, if you see, perpendicular to the plane of the coil. So that vector area and vector P, that angle is equal to 90 degree, and you have sine 90 is 1, the maximum torque would act, and that torque is equal to IAB for only one such single turn. In case of radial magnetic field, you have your coil placed in any direction and you will find that there is always a magnetic field in the plane of the coil, and the torque is equal to NIAB in that case. So this is how you see all moving coil instruments are actually going to function. So this animation will help you understand how moving coil instruments are going to work, and you can very well understand what is the principle of working and how is the theory of working of a moving coil galvanometer. That is what we wanted to say. Once again, we come to our mathematical part, that in case of moving coil galvanometer, we have proved that I is directly proportional to theta, or theta is directly proportional to I. That's what you actually see. So that is about moving coil galvanometer. In our next video, we will talk about the conversion of moving coil galvanometer into an ammeter. Well, thanks dear all for watching this video as well.